Mohammed, I'm from Effat University. Basically, the workshop today is about the visual effects and CGI in filmmaking. Previously, I major in computer graphics, 3D animations, and involve various things. Okay, I'm not really from industry, but I studied and researched about the visual effects and CGI. CGI is a computer generated imagery. So for today, you are going to be exposed. Okay, I'm going to share with you. This is all the contents that you're going to learn and know. Okay, the process that involve. Okay, we call it pipelines. The process. Okay. And the type of CGI means type of visual effects, because there's so many things in one film. Maybe they have 10 types of visual effects techniques and terminology. I mean the explanation of the term, the process involved, and some software and hardware, and also some case study. Case study is we take a look at how they make Titanic, okay? How they make Everest. If you watch Everest last year, it's very amazing. The mountain is 3D, and they put very details. You will see. I have lot of a video to show the examples, and some key players in the company who dominate these visual effects and CGI. So let me give you introduction about myself. I'm Dr. Mohammed. I'm from Malaysia anyway, and research, my PhD is about computer 3D modeling. I modeled the old fortress in Malaysia, which is no longer exists. This is back in 15,000 something. So we use the technology 3D to bring the things and to visualize it. So this is one of the CGI methods that we use. But research is different from the filmmaking, because we need to study a lot. And I love doing photography and love doing computer things, a lot of 3D graphics. And that's basically about me. So now I'm teaching at the Effat University, also visual effects subjects, 3D modeling, computer animation. So those are all components, okay, all sub topics about visual effects. Okay, visual effects, as you know, the meanings of visual effects is the method that we use to create something which cannot be created in front of the camera. For example, it's impossible to create futuristic environment in physical scales. Are you going to build the actual building there? No, it's impossible. So we build in computer graphic, or we build in the models, because later on I'll show you some examples how they build the models. If you see in the Titanic, the corridor, surprisingly, it's a small models, and the camera is inside, and the water coming in. So they play a lot with the speed of the film to make it look more realistic. So before we go into details, there is some history. Anybody know when actually visual effects starts? You can guess. 1970, 60. Anybody has idea? Yes, visual effects.
When
it started. Okay, surprisingly, it's more than 100 years. What you're going to see next is, this is the first animation, okay, using hand drawing in year 1900. Okay, the first animated film. So they draw one by ones. Actually, if you YouTube this, you will see this hand drawings film. Okay, there are about several stages. Years by years has been developed. So this is the first animated. And for this one, this is a movie called Metropolis. Metropolis in 1927. This is why I told you to shoot the futuristic building that time. They don't have, so they build models and they put the model behind and they make a composition like Photoshop. You put behind, you put another front. So final look will look like this. Okay.
This is only a model.
This is a models. Yeah. If No, actual building. Because it depends. Sometimes director wants, okay, this happened in year 3000. We need to imagine how the things look. So the artists come up with concept, until approve.
But still true building, right?
True model, yeah. But they put it very, very detailed. Okay? Then the artist is very, very good and very talented. They put later you see the Titanic's the making, the corridor it likes the actual physical room, but it's just this size, it's as big as you, so you can go inside. So the next one, this is method in CGI in the visual effects called matte paintings. Matte painting, instead of building the actual model, they make a painting. So this time. You can see, like, it looks fake. It looks fake because the technology that time is not as good as today. Today you can see it's very, very nice. But now, like this one, you can see like somebody in the studio, in the stage, and there is painting behind it, okay? So this same method used in Star Wars, the first Star Wars movie in 1975, also used matte paintings. So the term that I use here is all the CGI terms. Okay, if you watch this movie, this is Jason and the Argonauts. The first, how to create skeleton fighting with the real people. Anybody know how they make this thing? They shoot frame by frame, move the skeleton, shoot, move the skeleton, shoot. Then you see like it's not smooth like normal animation, but this is 1960, so still acceptable that time because there's no computer technology to create in computer. So if you watch this movie, you will see it's very funny movement of this skeleton because they need to compose with the actual humans. Okay, this involves with so many types of effects, and you can see it's not really. It looks still look fake, but they are the first who try to make something looks, because that time people will ask how you do something like this because we have no idea how you do these things. Okay, this is 1956. The Ten Commandments, I think probably about they cut the sea. Okay, something got to do with a prophet movie. So this is a compositing. This guy shot somewhere in the studio, and they have to build the tanks. They have to put the water, and they combine it. So a lot of models and some effects using water. Okay, if you want to know, I'll explain. We can have a question when I show this. So, okay, this is the first movie used to create twins. Okay, this is not twin. This is only one person. But Disney makes, we call it double exposure. Double exposure you can do with a normal camera. Like nowadays, if you use a Photoshop, you take, put on the tripod, you shoot, and you shoot second time, this guy on the left, this guy on the same guy go to the right. Then after that, in Photoshop, you can remove one of that and make it layer. You get two. You can get three, four, five, as long as it's not overlapped. So this technique in film, they rewind the film and shoot again. So this time, the second actors, the same actors, like trying to imitate it. Like you talk, okay, how are you? And the film rewinds, record again. So I'll be here, I'm fine. So There are two interactions. So nobody, and in the movie making nowadays, a lot of people talk alone. The CG characters is not there. Later on, the CG characters come in. So this is a double exposure. And this is 1975 Star Wars, okay? Star Wars is a lot of development in a movie being created. They use matte painting, they use physical model, they shoot in the studio, and they combine these two things, okay? So Star Wars is a lot of special effects. Okay, this is an American werewolf in, I think, in London. This used the actual physical makeup body. They built the actual model of this and used the actors to be inside. So sometimes they use a physical model to make visual effects. And this is the first computer generated characters in 1985. This is the first time human talked with nobody inside, nobody in this, and this guy actually in the computer, that comes later.
Cartoon?
No, this is young Sherlock Holmes, okay? The first CGI movie. Okay, after that, I believe you watch Jurassic Park. Okay, Jurassic Park is a very, very a breakthrough, which is, I really like about Jurassic Park because you cannot try to find where is the mistake here, because it looks very realistic. Okay, Jurassic Park, they use the actual physical models, they sculpt this dinosaur, and they also use the CGI. So there is sometimes they, when they go close up, the camera go close up, they need to use this one, the actual model. But sometimes they use CGI, it depends. Because a visual effects supervisor knows what time you need to use the actual model, what time you need to use CGI. Because there is still pro and cons. Okay, there is advantage and disadvantage. So the full movie in Toy Story, this time is 1995. So this is the first CGI movie using all computers, no more humans, okay? So this is quite successful. It earned about $6 billion and Academy 24 Academy Awards. So this time, they developed their own software. They developed their own configuration of hardware to bring these characters. If you can see Toy Story 1, 2, 3, 4, 3, you can see the different quality. But still a good reference. So this is The Matrix, okay? Yeah, The Matrix is another breakthrough because there is an old movie who has this kind of techniques. Do you know how they shoot like the freezing characters here? And the camera is rotating and this guy is freezing. You know how they do that? So they have placed dozens of cameras, still image, and they shoot at one time. So they combine. So like if I'm moving, at one time, camera take maybe 70 frames. So I'm freezing, that you can see the camera is rotating. Because they cannot use the single camera to rotate, because if the single camera is rotate, you are moving. They want to freeze the object. So one time, they need to shoot all at one time. So this is Matrix. And this is using 3D, but driven, okay, by another performance. Like me, they wear, or they call it motion capture. They put all the equipment, and I'm doing acting here, and this follows my actions. Okay, because they need to create something like the CGI characters with their own appearance. So you, it's impossible to create something outside in the physical thing. So they need to create in CGI. So this is the heart lockers, okay? This using a 2000 frame per second camera. So 2000 frame per second camera allows you to capture very small movement, slow movement. Imagine one normal film, 24 frames per second. So this is what you see when you move. You see everything's moving on the screen. This is 24 frames per second. So now they compress 2,000 frames per second. So if you watch this part, you can see small dust flying very slow. So this is Michael Bay's film. And okay, this is another development in computer graphics. Okay, they developed a new technique and a lot of new development in this, like to get the human to get the very nice skin or texture of this. This is totally in CG environment and combined with the actual people who talking alone. Okay, so I think same with the normal production, movie making or CGI, VFX, you have to have pre-production. Pre-production is where your idea comes. You discuss with the team, the script, then you start to do a concept and do a storyboard, okay? Okay, this part is very, very important in the VFX because, for example, you need to shoot visual effects scenes. And you don't have a pre-production, you just simply go and shoot. So when you come back, maybe you see, oh, this is not suitable. So what if your scene location somewhere in Australia or New Zealand, you already go there, you come back, and it's not what you want. So it's very costly. So that's why we use pre-production to have a look at the process. So this is some explanation about this process.
Pre-production is an essential part of the filmmaking process, during which you plan, budget, and schedule every detail of a production before you even pick up a camera. In the film degree program, you'll be working on a number of different film and video projects, and each of them will require pre-production work with the fellow film students who will be part of your filmmaking team. First, you'll need to break down your script into individual scenes and then sketch out storyboards to illustrate everything that you plan to shoot. Then you and your crew will scout locations, cast talent, pick out props and costumes, and identify any special visual effects that your film may need. During pre-production, you'll also decide what kinds of sets your film needs, and you'll be able to construct them on one of our on-campus sound stages. This is also when you'll decide on crew positions within your group and work out a production schedule that lays out when you plan to start shooting, what each day will consist of, and when you plan to be finished.
So this is just a brief idea. And normally when you finish the script, everything, we go to pre-visualization. You know what is this? Pre-visualize? Okay, in the movie making and in the CGI or VFX process, before you create the final one, at least you need to have some idea how the things look like. So this is the part where, if you see here, this is one of the movies.
Welcome to the previous comparison reel.
So
secret number.
The idea is to give some idea how the finals looks.
And on the right, the final
of the composition.
And as you can see, there are quite a few similarities. I was actually kind of surprised by how faithful we were to the initial exploration in 3D.
So they use 3D technology to do this.
Shot design. It really helped out for production design as well. We hadn't built the set for Ershan's room until after I, you know, kind of had blocked out the space and done a first pass of previs. And that greatly influenced sort of the size and look of.
So on the left is pre-visualized the actual scene they shoot.
In case of this alley scene, we had locked the location already, and so I was able to go there, take some basic measurements, and bring that, you know, model that out in 3D in a rough way, just so that, you know, size relationships were about the same, and go from there. As you'll notice, the scene had changed after a rewrite, so it ends completely differently. This elevator scene ended up being shot in three different locations. There were two elevators and a number of green screen shots, including this one. And the reason why we needed to take something simple and make it complex is simply to be able to execute the previs. We probably could have found and made do with a single elevator. But because I had a very specific idea of what shots we needed, you know, to communicate these beats, it ended up that we had to use like this combination approach. But it was really because I had done this thinking and this exploration that, you know, we knew how to even approach these disparate elements. This study scene has been recut a little bit. The previs on the left is stretched.
So, basically, the idea is to see what happened there in the actual things. And mesh movings, maybe some of you don't know, or you don't know at all what is this thing, mesh moving. Mesh moving is when you have the actual scene, okay, I want my spaceship landing there. So when you start to move the camera, it's very, very complex to put the objects and lock on the ground. So this is the technique we call mesh moving. This example show you how to put a hole in the actual street. And the hole actually is a CG hole. So this is, we call it plate, our background plate. We have no hole there, here. So the hole in computer graphics, okay, this is a hole. So 3D camera imitates the actual camera and we compose it. Okay? So this is 3D one. So this is not done yet because there is another element that we're going to put. Make it dirty. So we make, this is a dirty elements. We put it later. And put some smokes to make smokes coming out from the hole. So this is element by elements. So final composition, you will see. You see? So 3D and the actual things. Okay? So you get the idea. Virtual objects, actual objects. And this is rotoscoping or paint. So rotoscoping also involves taking other objects like this. Okay, this is the actual original footage. So rotoscope, they trace these things, and we take it out, and we can put in other place. Like this, okay? And we extract these cars, and we can change the background to others, provided the perspective is correct. Okay, like this is very obvious. This fighting scene somewhere on something not moving. Okay, and we extract this. We take this out. Okay, and we put it on the train, I think. So it looks like. Okay, so the idea we take put. In Photoshop, it's not moving, but in filmmaking, everything is moving. So all this process we call rotoscoping. The alpha is the transparency, transparent layer. So you see now, I take this, put another one. So this is the compositing and rotoscoping. And modeling, I think if you watch a movie, there's so many 3D models. Like this one is a Hulk, okay. Well, the Hulk is, you know, this is 3D models. Sometimes they scan the actual
decisions made early on in the project. One was the casting of Mark Ruffalo, not only because he has this great facial structure and he plays such a convincing manner, he's also a very patient actor, and he let us capture all kinds of data from him. And we built a marker.
So this is a 3D model
with tremendous.
Very realistic because the skin.
Marker fluency. We took a lot of the skin details, the grays of his hair.
So this is a 3D model.
Down to his fingerprints. So we made sure that all of that was in the model, just to give it that extra subliminal layer of mark. We took marker fluid to the light stage, which is kind of a dome of lights that the actor sits in, and then different cameras and lights fire, and it captures a high-resolution model of their head with high-resolution textures, and that's fantastic reference to have.
We did a texture shoot, especially to get his clothing, because we knew that his clothing was going to have to hold up in many, many shots, and it was going to have to rip apart. And we also did a life cast of his face, his hand, feet, and a dental mold. So even Hulk's teeth are sort of a hulked out version of Mark Ruffalo's teeth.
So this is the urethane cast of Mark Ruffalo's head. And you can see it's got detail down to the pore level. So what we could do is take this and do a laser scan, which gives us a higher resolution model than we can get in any other way. And then we hand this off to Chris Costa, who then can apply this to Hulk and ZBrush.
Once in ZBrush, I'm able
so
to-
So now it's 3D software.
To recreate all the details. So, you know, just like with traditional clay, I'm able to sculpt those wrinkles, you know, all the fine detail around the surrounding areas of the eyes and lips, and add all the fine pores and wrinkles and scars and things like that.
Everything we saw in Mark, we brought into Mark Ruffalo Digital Double, and in turn brought to the Hulk and then kind of exaggerated version of that.
So, what you see there is all 3D characters. Sometimes the 3D part, like Iron Man, only face the actual characters. The rest, 3D. So, rigging, this is physical effects. Physical effects means to make these guys flying, okay? You need to have wires and put and pull it like this. And then in the production, in the post-production, they will remove this wire. So this is physical effect. You need to be done there. Or else you need to build this in 3D, and there's a lot of process. So it depends which one is much cheaper cost sometimes. So, okay, this is quite interesting because this is an animation, okay? So what you see here, it looks like real because the artist is very good put lighting and texturing. And they make the camera shaking. So this is 3D models. So, 3D, and this is a 3D animations. Another process, putting textures, I mean, you see here, from plain like this, and become something like very detailed like this. This is a shoes, also in 3D, and put texture. Because texture will make your object looks more realistic. Another process is lighting and renderings, okay? So lighting and renderings, this is 3D objects. We put all lights to make it look realistic. Okay, like this sample. Okay. The objects just now is all in computer, the lights and so on. For the effects, like you see smoke, you see lights, you see laser things, so this is the effects. Like this one, taken from okay, this is effects, smoke. And much easier to control in the computer instead of you want to control the actual physical smoke. Go right, go left, go up, go down. So you can control with the computers. This is rain. Okay, this is computer generated. This is fireworks. So you can control everything. So finally, actually compositing. Compositing, like the one you see, I take this layer, I take scene, another scene, combine it. So you will see the example here. So putting all different parts, we call it compositing. And color correction to make it looks, see? So all different parts being combined. This is rotoscoping. It's 3D models. Texture, lightings, and some effects. So, compositing. It's quite interesting, right? A lot of trick and lies, actually. So we go to the types of CGI. Okay, if you want to have a drink, I think you can just have a drink. Okay, this is the one that I mentioned: miniature, small objects, models. Okay, so if you see here. Anybody can guess which one is model? What is which? Train? We take a look at which one is model. So to do the actual scene by using actual train is very, very expensive. So what we can do to do this method. So this involves artistic skill to bring this model. So I think the model is maybe this size. Yes, it's a model. And they paint to make it look real. So green screen part, because we want to remove, put in the actual scenes. This is also a model. Very detailed job. Even this is also small models. You see, very small objects. this is a testing part. So use slow speed film. So now the actual things. Maybe 5 second shot take weeks or months to complete because so many process, so very tedious. So this is main things. It can be digital, it can be traditional. Digital, the one that you use in Photoshop to create, to do a painting. But like Star Wars, it's very traditional painting. It's a very big size, maybe bigger than this room. They have to paint every single details, the scene, to make it look like real. So I think for this one, maybe this is digital matte paintings. So this very art, very talented artist creating this painting. So now the moving parts like this. So we want to remove and put another background. So the behind is a painting actually. So this is after color correction. Small pieces to make it look real. So you can see maybe 100 layers in Photoshop. Okay, so that's basically, so you get some idea, right? So this also involves various, okay, this one, actually you already see this, the mesh moving, the one that we put 3D objects in live action plate, composite things like this, the green screens and the objects and the characters. Pyrotechnics is the actual explosion, so this is not digital. Pyrotechnics normally involved with expert in explosions, okay, and the actual explosion will happen in the actual place, location, so it is not safe to be close to this area, okay, so this is normally with the crew, everybody will be far from the area that they are going to shoot, and the explosion will happen there. So if they want to put people there, like maybe this, let's say you want to put people on the near the cars, so the people will be shot against green screen and composite, so they need to acting like they are, you know, jumping or flying. Effect simulations. If you watched a movie called Twister, okay, the tornado, a movie called Perfect Storm, the storm on the very tsunami. So this is the method they do a research. Okay, this is computer graphics. Water before they build, bring to the actual movie. So it's also involved with the scientists who do the calculation and do the research about what is this thing actually. Okay, prosthetic. Prosthetics is quite old traditional visual effects methods. You want to create ugly face like this, you need to have a makeup artist who are very good at manipulate this face. I think we take a look at this.
Kind of like frizzy, so I wouldn't want anything.
Normally they would put in the actual face.
I'm Amy Macabeo with the Stan Winston School of Character Arts. In my web course, I will show you how to handle hair on prosthetic appliances.
Putting one by one hair.
And this is what Bruce was looking for. He did tell me that he wanted me to go a little bit more sparse. I'm going to start with blending the hair, both the color and the texture, in two different ways. How to map out hair direction. I'll go into cutting and styling of the hair, adding back.
So you see the actual human has been makeup with something.
This is a great technique to know.
I've seen Amy like just pull this out of nowhere before. She just like, I can do that. And she's a wizard, so go.
I'm really excited to show you all these different techniques, so let's jump in.
Okay, there is sometimes cheap way to create this character using the actual model with makeup, but sometimes there is thing that we need to create in the 3D. So okay, let's take a look at the jobs. Okay, in visual effects there are so many type of job. It can be from a compositor, concept artist. Concept artist is the one who create a concept before they make a film. For example, like okay, Toy Story, the concept artist will try to get how close the scene with their painting in the actual movie and their painting. Layout artist, mesh move artist. Okay, anybody know how many crew involved with average in one movie that involve special effects? Can you give?
20s maybe.
20s?
More.
Okay. Anybody else can guess? Normally, thousands of people. Okay, for one reason, I give you an example. If you want to create a character like Avatar have okay, character one. Maybe one character, two or three 3D modeler works in one model. Another characters, then another people. So, like Titanic, they have so many companies, visual effects companies, work together. Maybe 5 or 6 different company. So they give shot. Okay, these shots, company A do. So company A must do all these shots. Maybe 5 second shots. Another company do 10 second shots. So they divide this thing, because the timelines at the end, you have maybe production would take 1 year. So everything must work together at one time. There's no way that you finish this shot. Okay, give to other people shot. So everything goes at one time.
So every character has three
I just give examples.
Yeah, okay, I mean every each one has a different job or
okay. For example, you're going to build Woody characters in Toy Story. Uh-huh. Okay. There is guy who models only work on the clothes.
Clothes
is different story. It's not a model. Sometimes is a simulation. Clothes. So there is a guy who works on clothes, and the guy who work on the models, okay, and the guys who work on the texture, who paints every single object there, and the guys who work as a lighting artist, 3D who just get the light, right?
Different.
Yeah, different. And another process is animate. Animate is totally different people. The animator only animate the objects. And to animate the objects, you need to put the skeleton inside the body. That's different department. So many, many departments. So one big studios like Pixar have hundreds of people. And imagine maybe they have one, at one time, two projects. They have to double the teams. So it's a very tedious process anyway.
Even I make them for one character?
Okay, even for one character. For one character, it depends how complex. Because sometimes it's the design's not that complex. Maybe one or two people can work. But it's like Incredible Hulk just now. It's a very detailed process. It takes maybe weeks to do scanning, to do texturing, shooting. So it's very process. So this is basically the process involved pre-production, production, and post-production. So you see there is animations, and you also have effects animations, rotoscoping, so many, and finally compositing. The last one is compositing, where all the footage combined make it looks like final one. Okay, tool and software. Nowadays there are so many processes. I think before that, I think we go to the process and pipelines. So this is the general process involved. They call it pipeline, the process.
Management tools have developed techniques and artists in a way that we can do television very efficiently. We're doing some of the highest level effects for television. We're doing really the full gamut of effects, simulations, water, smoke, fire. We have set processes and tools that give us a great deal of confidence in doing photoreal water, for example.
The schedules on episodic television are usually very, very short. Often, sometimes as short as 2 weeks from the time we get a shot to until we have to deliver it as a final.
What we try to do is build in a little bit of time ahead of that if we can have a tight collaboration with our clients to add another week or two. But essentially, you're in a 2 to 3 week turnaround time for everything you're doing for an episode of television show. Our goal is that these could hold up in a feature environment. That's one of the reasons that we focused on really developing a super efficient pipeline communication system. And we have
the pipeline is the system in the studio,
our compositing tools
combined, connect with all the people involved
into a highly integrated pipeline that allows us to move at the pace we need to for television.
Our main goal was to make a very modular pipeline, basically a pipeline that would scale with time to actually put out more than 1,000 shots a week in CG and in comp.
For our bigger effects shows, take Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. as an example, or American Horror Story, we're doing anywhere from 50 to 200 shots in an episode. For Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., for example, a good proportion of those shots are all CG shots, or 80% of the screen is CG elements. So 50, 60, 70 shots at that level of complexity and with that much computer graphics is very demanding, and everybody has to be working in sync.
Well, we're the primary vendor on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., so we built many assets for this show, including airplanes, helicopters, flying cars, digital doubles, set extensions, water, fire, smoke. One of the things we've been adding also into this set extensions is a lot of digital characters in the background, and we're now using Populate 3ds Max, which has been a great tool to have. We use a mix of Character Studio and CAT with the characters in the backgrounds. We often keyframe specific actions in with CAT, and whenever we need mocap, we usually use Biped for that. But Populate has been a great tool for adding generic people idle in the backgrounds and people walking around as well.
Hell on Wheels has been a great show for us. Once they started to see our capability and the production value we can add with our CG elements and extensions, they started writing more and more into the show. So we ended up developing an all-CG environment that tied directly into some of their shooting locations and then went to full CG shots with the train crossing the trestle and the trestle being all-CG and really were able to fulfill their storyline in the season with a lot of our environments and CG shots.
So it's green screen, green screen.
For us was to really develop
some CG part.
It takes to somebody to take a train, put it on the tracks, and make it move.
And we now have tools that allow us to just literally draw.
So this is a software.
A few buttons,
and the software we use to create all this
on that spline that has tracks, and we have custom controls to add an engineer to the engine, as well as natural movement to the cars. This is the faster the train's driving, the cars will rock back and forth a little.
So this is the actual final scenes.
Manual work out, and that's what that tool ended up to be, and so many other tools that we have built in this facility.
Salem is a very dark show. We did these shots where a guy gets his face scalped off. This face was supposed to come alive at some point in the show. And this other practical effects house created this amazing prop that the client really loved. And they said, we love this face, recreate it exactly, but it needs to talk. So what we did is we took the practical prop, shot a bunch of stills of that, and we used ReCap software to basically reconstruct a 3D model from the practical prop. So that rough base model was then used to create a series of morph targets.
So this is facial animations?
Off the shelf facial.
We map this to this.
To recreate the performance of the actor.
This is 3D actually.
To drive the animation of the face.
Visual effects being what it is, it's a really challenging industry. And Fuse FX has really been able to establish itself as one of the key players for television. We feel like the artists, the tools, the systems that we put in place are a great foundation to continue to grow our capabilities. And we're looking forward to continuing to do more and more and bigger work for both television and features as well.
So you see like that guy is falling. It's a very split second, maybe 1-2 seconds. You cannot even notice the details. That's why we use CG, so nobody can notice that. If you want to use the actual actors, it would be very costly to set, to have a very high, to put the rigging and to shoot. So the tools, okay. The first picture you see here, this is a CPU. Okay, this is very important part, which because we involve with 3D animations, layers, compositing, so they need computing powers. So we call this a render farm, where you can rent these things. For example, if you live here in Jeddah, there is a company in maybe in US, in UK provide this thing. Okay, so you can send through the internet. Okay, I want to render scenes, maybe these scenes. Okay. Takes about 5 minutes. 5 minutes scenes, and they will, okay, because in movie we have frame by frame. So 24 frame in, for example, film. So in the computer animation software, you have 24 images for 1 second. So when you send this to this server, they will distribute. Maybe this have 300. So in one, at one time they render 300 frame. So distribute these small pieces of images, which is faster. So you just pay them, and you can collect through the internet. They send it back to you. And for the hardware, like this one, this is mobile workstation anyway. Because we in like visual effects involve with a very high demand of the computing powers. Okay. We need a very high processor to model the thing, to make the object looks in real time. So we need, it's not like a normal laptop. You need a very, very high and fast computer. So nowadays, you can get a lot cheaper compared to last 20 years, okay? So this mobile workstation, maybe you can get 10,000 real, okay? Which is a long time ago, you cannot even get this size of workstation. A long time ago, the machine is very, very big. Okay, I think let's go. You want to take a break or you want to continue? Because you're just watching. The next one is a case study. We take a look at how they make Titanic. Okay, this is an additional tools. Okay, most of the tools here are professional level, and there are dozens of other tools. Okay, this is the one that commonly used nowadays: After Effects, Nuke, Photoshop, and so on. Okay, let's take a look at the Titanic. So some of these.
We built the first class smoking room set with all the great wood paneling, beautiful.
So they built the actual set inside the Titanic.
The scene in the film where Cal socialized with the other first class passengers. Since the set was built primarily for the early pre-collision scene, we built it level on the stage. The irony is, in order to make it look tilted for the later scenes with Victor Garber, we had to tilt the camera and then have the actors lean to one side. We also made props like wine glasses and shot glasses with the correct tilt built into a solidified gel. We then used string to pull the glasses off the mantelpiece, which coupled with the tilt of the camera, completed the illusion. Show the ship actually sinking, we had to adjust the ship to a 6-degree angle. We then disconnect the front 180 feet of the ship and put it on hydraulic cables.
I think they have many type of size.
See the front section of the ship on camera go underwater as the water pours up on actors.
And all of these are stuntmen anyway. It looks like it's not the normal people.
Real people running along a really huge set. Though visual effects might have added a component into the set, basically it's 90% the real deal. Yes, this was back in 96 and 97, when we still did things with real people and real sets.
We designed a series of visual effect shots to take advantage of the big ship set in the later stages of the sinking. By filming a lock-off shot of the tilted main set, which didn't move, and a second shot of the sinking set, we could have ILM digitally combine them into one shot, creating the illusion that the entire ship was sinking while still seeing all of our actors and extras running around on deck without having to use a model or digital people.
So this is one of the first movies used a lot of digital people, 1997.
To make it look as if the ship was at a steeper angle. Then, digitally added a new waterline and horizon to disguise the extra camera tilt. We had a full-scale 40-foot truck tank painted up like a funnel that we dropped on the set to create a huge wave to swamp our light bulbs. But we also needed some wider shots with a miniature funnel falling behind and even on some of our characters.
The funnel that was used was 14 foot tall, order scale, and the plate that we got was a pull down view minus the funnel, in which there was a long, thin splash in the water that was accomplished by a line of primacord that was detonated in the water. So we had to retrofit our cable to hit that exact spot.
Fabrizio is the one that gets nailed by the smokestack. And there's a whip pan away from him towards this smokestack, and the live action is nothing there, it's just black. But the problem with the model was the weight. It was up in many hundreds of pounds. We solved some of the weight problem because of the fact that we weren't using any metal other than the framework. Parts that would come close to the camera were done with show card, basically cardboard that was painted. And oddly enough, the texture of show card when it was painted had the same exact feel as the metal would. There was a little bit of nervousness the first time we did it because we really didn't know how far it was going to fall, how hard it was going to hit.
So it's done in studio.
We did it several times, and when we did get it, this felt really good because it was all in camera. There was nothing else.
So sometimes the first shot is not good, they need to recreate the thing, then involve another cost.
These two separate pieces of film.
So it is not there, so this is the final.
We're talking about generally 60 degree water, long term exposure. Again, we have to watch out for life. I don't think you're going to have to tell anybody to get out of the water, guys. Of course, you get out of the water.
This is the actual full-scale model. This is the actual water, full scales, you get the actual full effects. So this is the one I told you, the models, the one that you see the water comes in, shot in the studio, and the water comes from the side to side.
It's quite long, and we had to create all these wall panels out of balsa wood and fix them so that they would break realistically. We had some very large drop.
With a slow speed camera, it looks like quite real.
Drop water flooded into these things. The camera zipping through there. It was just amazing how fast that camera went through that set. And I was very leery about pulling the camera that quick.
He did this great miniature shot, but Jim didn't think it was quite working when he first saw it until he rotated the shot in editing so that it was tilted. And that made all the difference.
For the jumps, when we had up to 40 people jumping off in one single shot, what everyone thinks is, oh, we had this ship, and there was all this water, and it was deep water.
Sometimes they use stuntmen, sometimes they use CG.
For most of the tank, it's only 3 foot deep. And we had a trough area that went out 20 feet from the side of the ship.
And background and action!
We had either dummies floating in the water with their life jackets on, or we had deck chairs made of rubber so people knew where they could jump. It was very important that when someone jumped, that wasn't the end of the shot. They needed to sort of swim to safety so the next person could jump and there was no risk of anyone landing on top of anyone else.
Let's hear it for the stunt team, folks.
We're currently on the poop deck of the Titanic, and it's a section that's been made that can actually...
This is another model, shot somewhere else, because they need hydraulics for these scenes.
Stunt people that we're just rehearsing on this section, just so we can get it to look...
So the stuntmen's all doing a rehearsal here.
...create the illusion of danger, but having it safe.
And surprisingly, all the materials is built from rubber.
A lot of safety parameters that went into it. They all had to be cabled, obviously.
And this is another trick. They put the ball inside of the safety jacket.
So we've all got to be prepared and know exactly where everyone's intending to go before we start.
We put human-shaped dummies that were completely foam around certain objects that couldn't be made of rubber. Some of the stunt performers would carry these dummies down with them. We made a lot of things in the end.
So this is rubber.
Coated things in rubber.
That looks like metal.
So that people could actually...
For safety.
And bounce off.
Because people
most of the tumbling
will hit that place.
At 25 degrees. That's where the stunt performers could still control to a degree where they went. And they wouldn't get really hard impact.
The section that we were shooting at was over 400 feet long, and we basically had to get people from one end to the other end and make it look as though they were sliding very fast, and the ship was only at 6 degrees. We had to make it look as though people were at a 45 degree angle and sliding down the deck. And we had people on cables, weighted cables, and we made these very, very small...
So this is the, actually the tilt the camera 45 degrees. Actually, to make it look like it's going down, actually it's straight.
But then you could actually spin 360 degrees. It actually worked very well.
Very early on in the prep of Titanic, I got together with Rob Legato, the visual effects supervisor, and we were going through sequences where it was impossible for stunt performers to actually do these things without seriously getting hurt.
When it was pitched up in the air, like it was there, it's 300 feet in the air. A stuntman can't fall that far into water and not break his leg, and that became part of our mission is to do these digital stunts, which are now very common, but back then...
So this is all digital stunts, all 3D models.
Fall off 40 foot.
Sometimes they combine the actual...
airbags.
We shot with two cameras and basically did our version of motion capture, which we called a roto capture.
He would then test it to see if he could use it for some digital stunt people falling down the set. At the end of shooting, we put on these black, sort of like skin-tight suits with all these balls.
So this is motion captures.
Things like
we capture the motion and apply to the digital models.
Hit, rubber,
this
mat,
is a skeleton.
Bounce, twist, somersault, and we were those CG guys, so to speak. And when we were doing the falls on the poop deck, which we only had a 100-foot section.
So the green screen, because they need to remove.
200-foot section.
At some point, the connection with the rest of the ship, we would have to do sort of a digital set extension and a digital stunt extension for that.
So the falls would all start for real, and then CG guy would take over, because we would actually come to the end of our fall or the end of our cable. I think the combination of the two worked out extremely well.
As early as late 1995, nearly a year before we shot the scenes, Jim already had a very clear picture in his mind exactly how to show the splitting and sinking of the ship, shot by shot. We use models and storyboards and all sorts of really low-tech tricks shot with a miniature video camera to build complete video sequences called Videomatics. With the Videomatics, we could show the visual effects companies exactly how we wanted the sequence to play. All they had to do was to look beyond the handheld shaky camera work and funky shots to see the grand and emotional sequence Jim had in his head and was ultimately able to put on film.
Well, what we're doing, we're sinking the damn ship. And right now there's a break area that's been pre-scored, and there's lead plating over on the side. And what we're featuring right now in this particular angle is the actual rip, where it actually separates and opens up the side of the ship.
So the model is quite big, actually.
It ends up being about like 1 second of the screen time. Cut!
Cut.
We're checking now, see if it looks good.
I'm holding your breath.
It will look great. D camera looks great. Let's see D camera.
So, produced in 1997, about nearly 20 years ago. So, these Titanics make the company nearly bankrupt because so many additional money needs to be injected because of a lot of things that need, because the James Cameron wants this movie to finish and involved with a lot of visual effects company. So the next one is Everest. Everest, you see a lot of cheating in compositing using 3D and also actual actors. When I watch the movie, I cannot see which one is 3D anyway. So this is 3D. Okay, the battery is running low. Thank you. so they have to pretend like they are in the actual Everest, but actually they are in studios. The rest of the jobs done by the compositors and visual effects team. So what you see is all elements by elements, layer by layer of footage of effects. So, okay, maybe the last one is Jurassic Park. This is, I believe all of you watched this movie, right? This is back 20 years ago also. Original, so they clean up. So this is again green screen. Compose and 3D objects come in. They have 3D cars, 3D dinosaurs. Actors are not there. This is all 3D and shot again blue screen.
Direction changes just like a flock of birds evading a predator.
This way.
So sometimes you have to do the physical effects in the actual place and bring the 3D, and it looks like in tracks. Okay, to finish this. Okay, these are the companies, and there are of course a lot of companies, but this is one of the quite famous company, like ILM, the one who created ILM, started in 1975 when they start Star Wars, and ILM also responsible for Jurassic Park, Terminator 2, and it's quite a lot of movie done by effects done by ILM. So to conclude this, I will give the final short video as a conclusion about this area, visual effects.
Every year, thousands of new films, adverts, computer games, and TV shows come out, and each one with more amazing creatures and mind-blowing effects than the last. You've probably watched some of these shows, seen some of these films, or played some of these games. What you won't know is that most of the VFX were made right here in the UK.
We end up making things inside computers, so anything that can't really exist in real life. It was my job to make a set of yogurt hands burst out of a yogurt pot, shoot into the sky, turn the clouds into a tornado, and bring them out into a rainbow.
Explosions, rain, smoke, stuff falling apart, blowing up. If you want to imagine that somebody's in a different environment, you would be able to remove whatever's in the background and replace it with whatever you wanted.
It's a really, really wide range of things, encompassing like a whole load of skills.
Obviously, I can't specify what films we're working on at the moment because they're highly confidential, but we have in the past worked on the Harry Potter films.
2012.
Inception.
Paul.
X-Men.
Prince of Persia.
Captain America.
Iron Man 2.
Sweeney Todd.
Batman Begins. The Dark Knight.
Those kinds of really big, awesome films. You get the film that's actually been shot on a set, then you have to figure out how that works in a 3D environment, doing something called camera tracking. And then you go and you figure out all your CG elements, that's computer graphic elements. And that can be anything from a character to explosions, smoke, all that kind of stuff. And then once you've got your 3D material, you put that together with the film image.
It is very challenging, but at the same time, it's a very creative process, and you get to put a lot of your own a lot of your own creativity and ideas into it.
I'm excited.
You could see the different layers of work that went in and how many people actually went into a single part of a movie. I am a 3D visual effects generalist.
The 3D operator, the tracker.
3D texture artist.
So this is all the jobs.
Software developer.
Production manager, VFX coordinator, assistant technical director. I like the idea that something that looked so creative could also be so technical. It's so amazing to do something that's sort of mentally challenging, technically challenging, as well as being creative.
I actually studied chemistry at university.
Maths, biology, sociology.
Music and art.
For A-level I did maths, physics and art.
Unbelievably, I did film, English, sociology and philosophy.
Computer science and art.
Most important quality, I think, is you need to be hardworking and devoted to what you do.
Sometimes what you learn in the university, you will not end up being what you want to be. Because in visual effect, it could be from many, many area or specializations.
I started as a runner, and it seems to be a very common entry point into this industry.
As a runner, you basically can be doing anything.
The washing up and getting tea, doing film brushes, even the heads of department. At the moment, they all started off as runners. Gives you a foot into the door, into the company, and you can learn stuff, then train, get to know the people.
And then generally within about 12 months, they'd move up into an artist position, and they'd be working on movies.
So it's kind of around the time Lord of the Rings came out that I really sort of fell in love with the idea of getting involved in visual effects. So going with a couple of mates and just filming some stuff and just taking it onto the computer and playing around with it.
Growing up, I was always like, it's just never going to happen. I'd love to make movies, but it's just never going to happen. Once I started reading more into it, I found out that there's this entire industry here.
I didn't really know about it. I didn't even think anywhere in London did this. I thought all of this stuff was done abroad, like America, China.
The thing I didn't know about before is the fact that they would take images of an actor's face and then put them over a stunt double. The fact that they make some of these 3D graphics from scratch, like nothing's on the page at the start, and then they've got these huge textures, 3D buildings, just come up with a nice end product, I think that's good.
The best thing about my job is probably that it's fun. It can be a lot of fun.
You know, you're sat there all day doing something that you love.
It's so rewarding that yourself and all the people that you know get to see the final work. And it really is priceless.
You'll just be sitting there flicking the channels, and all of a sudden your work will pop up there, and it's a really nice surprise. You just kind of go, oh look, I made that.
Yeah. UK has a fantastic reputation, and we compete now, or have actually overtaken the American side of things. This is why we're working on films of this sort of colour. It's a huge industry, and it's growing.
So, I think that's all the end of this. If you have any questions, maybe if I can answer, I'll try to answer. It looks, what's your opinion now? Is it very complex? It's very creative industry. Needs art, needs science combined to make things look believable. So I hope you get something about the process, the people who involved in this, and I also now handling this subject actually for IFAD students. So, any yes, please.
Why do need to make much move before?
You mean make a what?
Match move, you say? Match move.
Match move, ah, okay, okay. Okay, for example, I have a camera now, okay? My camera is moving from. If your camera is not moving, it's fine. You have no problem to put your 3D, for example, this is a 3D object, put it here. You can do it very straightforward, put it here. The problem, when the camera starts to move, okay, when the camera start to move, then how you want to lock this 3D things? Because 3D is a different environment in software. So you bring your footage, you shoot moving like that. So the 3D software needs to take the information from your camera like this and put here and make sure it is not moving like it, or else it looks floating like, you know. Is yeah, you take from different angles, okay? So the software need to know how you want to make sure this is stick there and follow the same angle, the one that camera you use. You need to imitate this angle in the software, also need to be the same. Or else, if the software use different angle, it looks like maybe it's here. Mm-hmm. Okay, the idea is to bring this, bring your information from this to this. So they have a special software just to make sure the angle is correct. So you can put your characters without any problem. Or else your character may be upside and down and your camera is not mesh. So any other questions? خلاص. So I hope you get something from today's talk.
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you advise any color correction software?
Yes. You asking me? I have color correction software.
I mean, no. The better color correction software.
Okay. Color corrections for still image, of course, Photoshop, but for moving pictures, you can use Premiere or After Effects. It is good enough. Okay, it's industry standard. But more advanced, like there is software called Nuke. This is more advanced. Nuke, N-U-K-E, N-U-K-E. And it's quite advanced also. But know this, industry use After Effects, Premiere is good enough. There's also another company, Avid, also has these facilities. But people can do at home nowadays with these machines. They can, you see a lot of, if you go to YouTube, you just type visual effects, homemade visual effects. A lot of people do these things. Okay? So I think we'll finish the session now. So thank you very much. And yeah, I hope you get something. That's more important things. Okay. Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.